All right, this is John Cole with growingyourgreens.com. Today we're actually at the Harvest Time Market Produce, You Pick, and Garden Center. All right, so we're at Harvest Time. They have a nursery, so they have plants and trees for sale. I didn't see too many edibles there. They have a produce shack that sells fresh, some of the produce they grew here, and then other produce. They also have they make sugarcane juice here. Maybe we'll go check that out in a minute. But the reason why I'm here today is I want to see how they're growing their You Pick strawberries hydroponically. And as I see, they're doing hydroponically and vertically. So wow, man, this is a trip. I've never seen a setup like this before. So let's see kind of what they're doing. So it looks like they have these poles mounted to the ground. Looks like it's metal, and then they got PVC on the outside here. Then they have these styrofoam boxes, like three of them. Kind of like what you put your beer in to keep them cool, but they're like really small. Actually, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them, actually. And they got them kind of like diagonal on top of each other to make small spaces where the roots come out. So actually, that is pretty close plant spacing, actually. It's maybe about 6 inches. And looks like they're doing really good. Look at those ripe strawberries on there. And the water source, they basically just have a drip tube up here. It's like a 5/8 drip tube. And let's see, looks like the water just basically gets injected into the top here, into this dirt. And then it just kind of maybe trickles down into the different ones. And look, this is cool, it spins. So, man, imagine harvesting these, you're walking along, you go to each one, you just spin it around. Okay, ripe one, okay, next. And you don't even gotta move around the plant. Man, this is the most incredible system I've seen for growing strawberries ever. I mean, this is really cool. I mean, you could do this at your house. And even the spacing between them, I mean, you don't really need that much space between them, just enough to maybe so it doesn't shade each other out. There appears to be about, I don't know, 3 feet approximately between each set of strawberry plants. And this way you could like get, there's four times 1, 2, 3, 4, 16 plants per upright, and then times that by all these. I mean, this is really efficient use of space to grow the most strawberries hydroponically. Well, I don't know if I'd call it hydroponically because there looks like to be some soil in there. No, it's not soil actually, it's a sponge-like material. So it's some kind of hydroponic grow medium. So they are growing hydroponically technically because it doesn't appear to be dirt. I'm not gonna rip it up and see what they're actually growing in. But yeah, this is a really nice setup. I don't know if they like came up with this design or saw it somewhere else where they're using it commercially, but man, there's just lots and lots of strawberries here. And so for those that are curious, they are not organic here, so they do spray. So actually I will not be buying any strawberries today, but this is amazing to see how they're actually doing it. And you know, I'm positive that you could probably do this organically as well, because you don't need to spray them pesticides on the food. Okay, now this is the You Pick strawberry and tomato field, and it says, do not eat picked produce before washing. That's always a good idea when they spray pesticides. So let's see. So here's how they grow conventionally, or how I've seen it conventionally done, strawberries. And this is how, you know, similar to how I planted my strawberries, but probably closer together. There appears to be, I don't know, maybe like a, there's actually about a foot, maybe like 10 inches, you know, between plants here. So, you know, maybe that depends, 10 inches, a foot between plants and the rows, all the way down, just fields of strawberries. So this is how they're conventionally grown, in the ground, on mounds. And it looks like they're doing pretty well here. So, you know, that setup over there is definitely unique and really cool. You could pack in much more plants, but it's gonna cost a lot more to set that system up and get it running than to, you know, mound up some dirt and plant it and put some cover on it. Let's check out what else they have growing over here. All right, now I'm in their tomato fields. And let's see, this is how they do the tomatoes. Probably about every 2 feet, they have a fairly thick stake in the ground. And this is a good example. There's a stake there. They have a stake here. They just tied it with string. So as the plants got taller, they tied it with the string, wrapped the string around and kept going down and keep the main stalk of the tomato plant between the string. And they're probably gonna do another row of string here, although their stakes aren't very high. So I imagine this variety of tomatoes is not a variety that'll get really tall. Kind of looks more like a not a patio, but some other variety. I'm not exactly sure what commercial varieties they are, but they're the standard red bouncy bounce tomatoes that probably don't get really super tasty. Well, this is an example of how you could stake your tomatoes fairly inexpensively. You know, the steaks are really cheap, and stake them up and use some string. Almost here to the end of the bed, and they just have, thousands of tomato plants here. I didn't count how many. It's like every foot, and man, this row is pretty dang long. And they just have fields and fields of produce growing here. Oh, and next to me here, it actually looks like every other row they planted something else. So they have onions going in this row. Let's see what else they have. Can you say tomato fight? I wish I was here with somebody and we'd have a tomato fight with all these rotten tomatoes on the ground. That would be so fun. Hey, post down below if you've ever had a tomato fight. I want to know. I never want to waste any of my tomatoes, but hey, if there's somebody else's tomatoes already rotten, that'd be super fun. This is how they do their peppers. The peppers are spaced out about a foot, again, 10 inches to a foot. And basically this is how they do it. They put a stake in the ground, and that stake's probably every 6 feet or maybe 10 feet. And then they just wrap it with string to guide the pepper plant to keep it upright, because they will tend to kind of bend over and keep them upright. And I suppose if they grow taller, they're gonna put another line of string a little bit higher. And here's fields and fields of peppers. Now, they're growing so many different things here. It's always nice to come to see how they're doing it in a commercial situation, so we can emulate that, because hopefully if they're doing it for a commercial situation, in most cases, if they're in a commercial situation, they're doing it for one thing, profit. And if they're doing it for profit, then that means they're gonna do whatever they can do to increase their yield, because their yield is in direct proportion to their profit. And the quality of the produce has no relationship really to their profit. How many pounds? Because most produce is sold by the pound or the bunch. And so how much pound of food can you generate in the smallest amount of space? So they could probably do things a little bit tighter, and if they did, there would be more labor. So it's always a compromise between labor, spacing, resources, and all many different things. So as a home gardener, you could have the labor, you could do the close spacing and emulate some of the things that make, you know, farming profitable, like here on the farm that we see now, to emulate them, like the spacing, like the trellis, the, you know, growing it up with the string and the stakes. But also we could add that quality that they don't have here, that they don't really care about so much, is the quality or the taste. Because we're not going for pounds, hopefully. I mean, I'm going for pounds, but I'm also, more important is to me the quality and the taste. I want to have the highest quality produce, and hopefully you should too. So we could combine all that, because when there's money involved, you know, once again, they just want to make the profit. And even if they have to spray pesticides or whatever to make it easier, because guess what? When you spray pesticides, it's easy. It's a quick fix. It's a solution. It's not good for us probably to eat those pesticides. It's not good for the environment, for those pesticide residues. It's only good for the chemical companies that make those pesticides and the farmers that's growing the stuff, because it's really easy to come and just spray everything, right? So we don't want to use pesticides. And when you do it yourself, you could use natural controls, pick off the bugs, use predatory bugs, and use some natural controls. But see, these things, while they do work, you have to be more diligent and be on top of it. And once again, that would translate into more labor if you had a farm, and labor is probably one of the biggest expenses of any farm. These are their cucumbers, and they're letting their cucumbers sprawl out instead of trellising up. And you know what? They could afford to do this, and guess why? Why? Is because they have so much space here, and if I had this much space, I wouldn't trellis my cucumbers up, because guess what? That takes more labor. And I have labor. I can do it myself. Oh man, look at these cabbages. These cabbages are amazing. So these are how cabbages grow. And what they normally do is they just pluck off the middle. So here's one they didn't pluck off yet. It's a cabbage. And let's see, when they harvest it, they just pluck it off and leave the outer leaves. And that plant's pretty much not gonna do anything else for the most part. It might sprout some side shoots like this, but it's pretty much for them not really financially viable anymore. But for us at home, we could definitely eat all these leaves. And besides, you know, most people think they could just eat this main cabbage ball. all these leaves are edible. You know, it tastes like a collard or a kale. So after a hard day's of work, I get a treat. And this is one of my favorite treats in the world. I'm eating a grass or drinking a grass. And this is a great machine. It's a sugarcane juicing machine. And this is cool because most sugarcane machines aren't clear. And look at that, you could actually see the sugarcane literally just getting crushed by those rollers and this pulp coming out. So it goes in like this big sugarcane here, nice, rich, and juicy. And then it comes out this dry pulp with all the juice extracted. So that's one of my favorite ways to drink or eat sugarcane is juiced. Now this is a nice treat, and you probably shouldn't drink this every day because it is really high in sugar. After all, this is where we get sugar from. So this is the most natural sugar that you could be eating. It's just fresh pressed from the sugar cane. Look at it, it goes through a screen, comes out. You can buy this by the pint or by the half gallon, and I'm getting a half gallon today.